fellow Pixar fans across the world, and welcome to the latest episode of The Kingdom of Isolation, where in times of trouble, why not isolate yourself with the magic of Pixar? Just a quick heads up, we've been dealing with a couple of technical issues on Jack's end for the last 10 minutes or so. So if his camera goes off, that's why. But he'll still be here. The microphone still works fine. It just might be a case that he just might need to get a new webcam. But nevertheless, technical issues aside, today we are covering the first official Pixar sequel, the first of many on the channel, Toy Story 2, released in 1999, just a year after A Bug's Life. And of course, it wouldn't be The Kingdom of Isolation without having a guest on board for this series. One physical issue I have on my end is we're recording this on November 1st. I've had a really busy weekend with karaoke competitions and doing some commentary for a couple of F1 leagues that I'm part of as well. So, it might sound okay for you guys, but for me, my voice sounds like it has been shot. But regardless, nevertheless, great weekend. Back to business. Toy Story 2. My guest today, he was with me for the first Toy Story film last time, which you can find in the top right of your screen in the new Pixar playlist for The Kingdom of Isolation. Jack McDonald's back.
Hello, excited as always. Yeah. Always loved part of the Toy Story.
Yeah. Disney folklore states that sequels don't exactly go over that well, especially when it comes to the Disney direct-to-video releases, which I will get to eventually. I did find out that some of the direct-to-video releases aren't actually on Disney Plus right now, so I will be able to cover all of the direct-to-video follow-ups at the moment, but the ones that are on Disney Plus, I will cover those. But nevertheless, like I say, all the Pixar films are on Disney Plus, and Pixar have been very... we said this when we covered Toy Story. Pixar have been very consistent with their quality of films, and especially with sequels like Toy Story 2. This is up there as one of the best animated sequels that's ever been made. So I say we shouldn't waste any more time, and let's jump back into the toy box. And I'm not talking about the toy box from Kingdom Hearts 3. You've got another 3 months to wait for that one, folks. Which reminds me, how are we going to cover Kingdom Hearts when we get to doing that episode? How do we go about that? As far as doing the research for the series and the games, the characters, like, how do we go about that?
That's a list. That's a list and a half to go through.
Yeah, because those that know the Kingdom Hearts series very well know how confusing the plot for the series is.
I've got a book that describes each character and stuff, and it is massive. So you can only imagine.
Oh, boy. Yeah, that's going to be interesting. But nevertheless, we'll worry about Kingdom Hearts another day. We're jumping it back into the toy box for Toy Story 2. Or in this case, heading to Al's Toy Barn for Toy Story 2. And as per the unwritten rules for The Kingdom of Isolation, spoiler alert in place if you guys still haven't seen the film yet. So, the opening credits here. Just this opening scene. There are a lot of references to things sci-fi related. The opening credits, especially, does draw references to the opening crawl from the Star Wars films, and then once we get the Disney Pixar title card, Gamma Quadrant Sector 4, we see Toy Story. We see Buzz. Back in action, voiced once again by Tim Allen. They did manage to get a majority of the original cast back for this back for this follow-up. So, but I'll still go through the car. I'll still go through the full cast list anyway. But yeah, when he gets onto this planet, what he's flying through, it was meant to be the river from A Bug's Life, but with some sort of issue with the software that the Pixar team were using, the rocks ended up looking like they were floating. But the team ended up deciding, let's keep this and turn it into something sci-fi related. Now, this actually also ties into a deleted scene that I mentioned in the first Toy Story episode. Yes, there were a few elements that were deleted from Toy Story 1 that are used here in Toy Story 2. And this is one of them. The element of the opening scene from Toy Story 1 originally being an episode of the Buzz Lightyear TV show, which would then become official in Pixar canon with the adventures of Buzz Lightyear of Star Command. So we've got that. But here, in this case, it's a video game. And there's more Star Wars references here, including one particular point where Buzz shoots one of the surveillance cameras, and the sound effect is the sound of a blaster from Star Wars. So, like I say, they went all out with all the sci-fi references here, but it's not the last one they would make, because there are actually quite a handful of Star Wars references in this in the opening scene. So this is from the IMDb trivia page for the film. So the video game opening scenes feature several references to the Star Wars films. The robotic scanning device that popped out of the rock face resembled the gatekeeper droid for Jabba the Hutt's palace in Return of the Jedi. Buzz is traveling through the tunnel in Zurg's fortress and it closing in behind him upon entering. Spiked wall trap aside, taken from Empire Strikes Back, and from A New Hope, Zurg's line, which we'll get into shortly. The ground's opening up underneath Buzz. The Z speaks for itself. You've got the Z on the screen. Could you be any more on the nose with who it is, with whose lair it is? But hey, at least we get to see Buzz's glow in the dark feature come in handy. And then we actually hear Zurg's first line in the film: "Come to me, my prey." And he activates the lever, which is where you've got the spiked wall trap coming into play. Thankfully, Buzz manages to escape. And then he sees on the other side of the the room he's in, something that says that it's the source of Zurg's power. And you've got these platforms that he's on. Pay very close attention to the music, folks, because this is another sci-fi reference to arguably one of the most one of the most iconic films of its generation. The music's from the beginning of a 2001 A Space Odyssey, folks. But of course, I can't exactly use too much because, you know, copyright and all that. But anyway, but then he takes a double step, falls, but one new addition to Buzz this time around is that he's got this anti-gravity shield, which effectively, like, just big shield around him, which, if you pay attention as far as Easter eggs are concerned, is definitely a reference to what Violet can pull off as far as the shield is concerned in The Incredibles 5 years later in 2004. So he tries to grab the source of Zurg's power, but turns out it's actually a hologram.
Hold up. Wait a minute. It's a trap.
Zurg comes up through the platform, and Zurg is, believe it or not, folks, he's actually voiced by one of the writers for this film, Andrew Stanton. And it's not the first time that Pixar or Disney have done this, that they've had like somebody from the crew voicing one of the characters in the film. I mean, we've seen it happen previously, and it's not the last time it's going to happen. But this is the reference to A New Hope that I was about to mention, where Zurg goes, "So we meet again, Buzz Lightyear, for the last time." It's a paraphrase of what Darth Vader said to Obi-Wan Kenobi shortly before dueling him in A New Hope. And this also occurred during the... And this also occurs in a scene later on in the film. And then Buzz kind of gets shot in half, and then we find out it's just a video game that Rex is playing. Yeah, Wallace Shawn back reprising the role of Rex. He's concerned that he's not going to be able to defeat Zurg, and he does bring up a valid point. Look how short my arms are. I can't press the fire and jump button at the same time. And while all that's happening, Woody is having trouble finding his hat because he's meant to be going to summer camp with Andy. Woody is voiced once again by Tom Hanks. Now with some of these names, Walter Shawn I've brought up previously, Tom Hanks, Tim Allen, I've brought those names up previously. I went through their film resumes just a couple of weeks ago. So if you want to hear what films they got that they did, you can watch the Toy Story episode in King of Isolation, where we go through the film resume of these characters. Everybody else that's back here, you got Don Rickles back as Mr. Potato Head. Jim Varney as Slinky, John Ratzenberger back as Ham, Annie Potts as Bo. One of the new cast members this time around is Estelle Harris, who voices Mrs. Potato Head. Now this is where I'm beginning to wish I kept that cast list up. In saying that, though, I've got the Wikipedia page handy, so is that... Whereabouts are we? There we go. Estelle Harris, that's who we're after. So everybody's trying to work out where Woody's hat is, but they're not having much luck. But Ham is using what looks like Morse code with a set of blinds. Okay, creative, fair play. Right, so, anyway, Estelle Harris. Mr. Potato Head actually finds the missing ear that she's been trying to find, with an earring in it as well. Estelle Harris, what has she been in? Her first major film role was Once Upon a Time in America in 1984. Stand and Deliver, Lost and Found, the same year Toy Story 2 came out. She was the old lady. You'll see, she's done a couple of other Disney projects after this. She would actually reprise her role as Mrs. Potato Head throughout the rest of the franchise, Toy Story 3, Toy Story 4, and the Toy Story shorts as well. The other Disney project she's been part of, she was the old Lady Bear in Brother Bear. She was the voice of Audrey in Home on the Range. Mrs. Boogin in Teacher's Pet, same year Home on the Range came out. She was Mama Gunda, however you pronounce that, in Tarzan 2. Television roles. She's been in like Law and Order. She was Estelle Costanza. And yes, that is a relation to George Costanza from Seinfeld. She was in an episode of... she's even done a couple of Disney TV series as well. The Aladdin TV series in 1995 in the episode While the City Snoozes, and an episode of Timon and Pumbaa as, for some bizarre reason, Timon's mother. Again, again, for some bizarre reason. There was a TV series of The Mask as well in 1996, a couple of years after the film came out. Adam's Family Reunion as Grandma Adams, which was a television film. Hercules TV series as Phil's mother. Okay, so
Timon. Oh, mothers.
Okay, so Timon's got a mother and Phil's got a mother. what else has she done? Wild Thornberries as well as the iguana slash turtle in Eliza Ecology. That's the name of the episode she was in. She was a guest on the Rosie O'Donnell show. She even appeared on the Sabrina the Teenage Witch back in 2001. She was Dora in the episode Sabrina the Muse. Oh my God. And yeah, we can add Estelle to the ever-growing list of names that have appeared on Family Guy. Yeah, she's appeared on Family Guy as it's another mother character she plays here. Specifically, Death's mother.
What did he say?
Okay. She even made a couple of game show appearances. One on The Weakest Link in 2002, and then later that same year, a reboot of Press Your Luck. She was also on Test the Nation in 2003. She was Helga in an episode of The Proud Family back in 2003. She even appeared on Kim Possible for a handful of episodes as Mama Lipsky. Yes, it's another mother figure. She's done a lot of mother figures. What else has she done? Phil of the Future, The Sweet Life of Zack and Cody as Muriel. The Emperor's New School, which was the TV series that followed up from The Emperor's New Groove. Don't worry, folks. Shouldn't be too long now before we get back into the realm of traditional Disney animation, but because I've got Fantasia 2000 all the way up to Bolt. So we've got that. So that'll be another like, 10, 11 films, give or take. Mrs. Mudka was the name of the character in The Emperor's New School. Marty's wife in an episode of American Dad. She reprised the role of Estelle Costanza in an episode of Curb Your Enthusiasm. Another Disney show on her list, Sunny with a Chance. The main star of that one was Demi Lovato, just for the record, folks. Would you believe it? We've got ourselves another mother figure in the form of Sylvester's mother in an episode of the Looney Tunes show, which is that's a reboot of the Looney Tunes cartoons back in 2011. 2012, she was Velma Farnsworth, who I assume is related to Professor Farnsworth in some capacity in Futurama. So the last television role she had was Mima D'Angelo in a television film called The Slice back in 2015. She's still she's still going, believe it or not, folks. She's actually let's actually leave that a little bit. Yes, she's still here, folks, but I'm just gonna leave it at that, because being a gentleman, you do not ask a woman her age. And we'll leave it at that, folks. Anyway.
Smart man.
yes. And of course you've got one Arlie Ermey back as as Sarge. You've got this, I believe, might be a interesting. Yeah, that's interesting. John Morris, I've just found out, is the voice of Andy throughout all four Toy Story films, interestingly. But they did get different actors for the younger Andy in Toy Story 3 and Toy Story 4, but we'll cross that bridge when we get to those films. Laurie Metcalf back as Andy's mum as well. And I believe that's everybody. Yes. Yeah, that's everybody. Yep, that's everybody covered. But Slinky does manage to find Woody's hat, and then Woody asks where he found it. Yeah, that's the bad news. Cue Buster the bark. And this is although he was uncredited for it, folks, not the first time I've brought the name up, and it won't be the last. Frank Welker, who I've mentioned previously, he did a lot of the animal vocal effects for Disney, and now you can add Pixar to that mix, as well as I've mentioned previously, the English dubs for a lot of the Studio Ghibli films as well. Which reminds me, I still need to get around to watching more of those, more of the Studio Ghibli films. Which begs the question, which one do I go with next?
Start with my favourite, Howl's Moving Castle.
Okay, add that to the list. That's my next one. I'm tempted to do the Studio Ghibli films, because a lot of them were distributed by Disney, for the English dubs anyway, but because of how protective Studio Ghibli are with copyright, it would get blocked immediately once the video goes live if I showed any clips from the film. So what I'll have to do is I'll probably still have something like the setup I have, like the background of the film in question. I'll still have that, but I'm going to need to go back to like the old format that I had, where I just talked about the film and I didn't have any clips or music from the film, just to be on the safe side, because like I said, I thought Disney were bad with copyright. Studio Ghibli, turn it up to 11. But anyway, Buster is now trying to find Woody. And lo and behold, no big surprise there. He manages to. And the clock on Mr. Spell, 13.5 seconds. That's how long it took Buster to find Woody. Another 4 seconds, and he'd end up beating Usain Bolt. Now, it doesn't state whether it was 13.58 or 13.50. It just says 13.5. So, but yeah. Another 4 seconds, Buster, and you might just beat Usain Bolt. But anyway, Andy comes in. He goes because Andy's mum with Molly, they're getting ready to take Andy to summer camp. He hasn't got much time left, so he decides to have like one last role play scenario with all his toys. What shall it be?
Death by shark or death by monkeys?
Ends up choosing Buzz Lightyear, saves the day, the partnership there, and then rip. Oh. Yeah. We kind of have a rip on Woody's arm now, which is not ideal.
Also very relatable, as when I was a kid, I often broke toys like that.
Yep, we've all been there. We have all been there. But yeah. Andy decides to head to summer camp without Woody, unfortunately. Woody ends up on the shelf. The thing is, bear with me. Andy's mum does say that toys don't last forever. She says that, but the thing is, this one here, it's got a bit of wear and tear here and there, but the thing is, I've had this for nearly 30 years and it's still going strong.
Same.
I was about to say how long have you had it there for? Oh, right.
24 years. We rip in the leg, but I've had it since I was born, the day I was born.
This was from my first Christmas.
So they do last.
Yeah.
You just have to take care of them.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like I say, a couple of rips here and there, but hey, like I say, nearly 30 years and he's still going strong.
That'll do it too.
But yeah, then we get to... And we get to what ends up being a more terrifying version of the deleted scene that we got from the first film. That nightmare scene. Oh boy. Because there's a little bit of foreshadowing there towards the end of this particular part, where the cards that I believe it's Ham and Potato Head that are playing. I believe it is. I might be wrong on that one. But yeah, all the cards they have are Ace of Spades. Now, that is a reference to some fortune telling where the Ace of Spades represents death in fortune telling. Pleasant. Oh. So yeah, the nightmare plays out where Andy ends up sounding a bit like robotic with his voice, not like actually sounding like a robot, but just like monotone. He realizes he's broken, doesn't want to play with Woody anymore, falls through the cards, and then you've just got that spotlight in the shape of that spade from the card, and then you've got all these broken toy parts turning into this monster. Woody's trying to get out of the trash can. They grab hold of him, pull him back in. Lid closes over. Yeah, that was terrifying back in 1999.
I remember I used to be terrified of it as a kid. I used to have to actually hide my eyes during that part.
And I don't blame you for that one. I do not blame you. Yeah, like I said, that's a more terrifying version. Than the deleted scene from the first film. Because the deleted scene in the first film saw the nightmare climax with Woody being engulfed by cockroaches. Here, he's got broken toy parts just keeping him on the bottom of the garbage can.
It's very much like a horror.
Exactly.
I think it was obviously very purposefully done like that, but it is terrifying because of it.
Yeah, like I say, you're not wrong on that one. But thankfully, Woody wakes up, albeit like that, which again, a bit on the nose, but pretty terrifying at the same time. But that being said, he actually whacks the arm off the books that are next to him, and this next bit here actually made it into the Guinness World Records. If I can find it. Where is it? That's the one we're after. Yeah. The dust in the scene where Woody ends up meeting Wheezy set a world record for the most number of particles animated for a movie by computer. I'm not even going to try to think of how many particles they used, but the dust looks very realistic here. Now, bearing in mind, again, we're still in the early days of Pixar, folks. This is only their third film. And you can already tell that there's been a significant upgrade in the quality of the animation compared to 1995, when the first Toy Story film came out. And this is where we get introduced to one of the new toys. And it's Wheezy. He's meant to be a squeaky penguin, and he is voiced by Joe Ranft. Now, I brought his name up in the last couple of episodes for Pixar. He was Lenny the Binoculars for the first Toy Story film, and he was also the voice of Heimlich, the caterpillar from A Bug's Life. And I'm pretty sure he's had a couple of other Pixar roles beyond that. But yeah, something I never actually noticed until I actually watched the film over the weekend, that if you actually look inside Wheezy's mouth, you can actually see the squeaker is actually broken. You can actually see that part of like the mesh for the squeaker that he's meant to have is actually broken.
I've never noticed that.
Yeah.
Always just, as a kid, I always kind of just assumed that he was broke. I never really paid super, super much attention to it.
Yeah. But then we have an emergency staff call, roll call, whatever Woody calls it, because we've got a yard sale on the way. And Andy's mom decides, let's see what we can use for this yard sale. You've got stackable rings, a jigsaw, a couple of books. And she decides to take Wheezy to the yard sale as well. Woody tries to whistle for Buster, but doesn't work. So he has to use his ripped arm to do the whistle. I'm beginning to wish I went through the extras for Toy Story 2 now on Disney Plus with like extended seasons. But nevertheless, Woody says to Buster, just act casual, and there's being casual, and then there's taking it to the next level. and Woody's just like, yeah. I'm literally on the same wavelength as him. Just like, not that casual, Buster. So just walk normally. And this is where we get introduced to Al, for the first time. Well, his full name is Al McGuigan. Yes, that's his full name, folks. Voiced by Wayne Knight, who has been in a Disney film previously. He was one of the side characters in Hercules back in 1997. But a year before that, he was Michael Jordan's assistant in Space Jam.
Space Jam. Yes.
Yeah. Talking about, you've seen the new Legacy, right?
Yep.
Oh, the fact that they acknowledge the first one is canon. That's brilliant.
I was hoping, and I don't know why I was so hoping, but I was hoping, and it was amazing. It was a great film.
I was about to say the Michael Jordan cameo. Not the Michael Jordan we were expecting, yep. though. And I thought, that is just brilliant. I mean, I was like bouncing up and down in my seat. Are they actually going to get the Michael Jordan? And it turns out it's Michael B. Jordan, who, what's he been in? I don't think what he's been. He's Apollo Creed's son. In the Rocky/Creed franchise. He's done a couple of superhero films. So he's Killmonger in Bloomin' Black Panther. That's where he is. I was trying to think. I know he's been in the MCU.
When I saw him, I couldn't figure out where he was from. I actually had to look it up because I just couldn't remember.
Yeah, but. Those sort of jokes in A New Legacy were in there specifically for those that had seen the first film. I mean, especially the fact that they broke the fourth one. You're asking me, a cartoon bunny, to gather a team together for a high-stakes basketball game to save the world? Sounds awfully familiar. And I thought, they even know the first film is canon! Oh boy. But anyway, Woody manages to rescue Wheezy at the expense of being knocked off Buster. And then you get one of these kids that like, I found this cowboy doll. And then their parents it's just like let's leave it because of his ripped arm. Drawstring, there's a snake in my boot, and this is where we hear Al speaking for the first time. And the way he's acting, you're just like, yeah, this guy is determined to get Woody at all costs. I mean, he even offers $50. To buy Woody.
Which was a lot more money than it is nowadays.
Yeah. I mean $50 back in 1999 for that Woody doll. Not bad going. But the thing is, Andy's mum has stated numerous times to him, Woody is not for sale. So she locks him inside the money box that she has to make the transactions for the yard sale, because remember, this is 1999, contactless don't exist yet. but then we see Al having a letter, and you've actually got Buzz in the background giving a like some sort of running commentary as if he's like, that's a Space Ranger mentality coming into play there. Just like surveying the scene, just like going through all the minute little details, see if they spot anything suspicious. And then boom, Al gets the bright idea to shove a skateboard to cause a little bit of carnage. And he uses a screwdriver to pick the lock of the money box that Woody's in.
From the very first scene, I can't stand Al.
Yeah, but the thing is, he's not like. But the thing is, folks, he's not like the main antagonist of the film. But we're not going to say who it is yet, because we haven't reached that point yet. But Buzz tries to rescue Woody, but gets knocked off Al's car. Regarding Al's car, while I'm on the subject, it has a resemblance to Flo from Cars in 2006. Now, those that are very clued in on their Pixar Easter eggs will know that Pixar like to put Easter eggs in to their for their previous films and their upcoming films.
Mm-hmm. I mean, and one of my favorite things to do by watching them.
Yeah, with the next film, Monsters Inc. especially, there's quite a few. There's a couple of Easter eggs like towards the end of the film, but I've got good old Michael McGorry from Movies and Milk making another appearance. It'll be his first Pixar appearance. He'll be helping me cover Monsters Inc. And The Incredibles, and when we get round to that. We get to Al's apartment, and we've actually found out, was that something I just found out as well, that a lot of that there's no floor 13. So when it is that's for a later scene. Getting too ahead of myself. So Woody's trying to take in his surroundings, and he's picked up by Bullseye of all people. Bullseye is probably my favorite side character from this film. Next to yep, good old Jessie. She is an absolute blast. She is up there for me another firm fan favorite character from not just this film, but throughout the entire franchise. She is voiced by Joan Cusack. Now, regarding Joan, she one particular film let's just say for the rock fans out there, and just the word rock, I mean, you guys will know exactly what film I'm on about here. School of Rock alongside Jack Black. Oh, one of my favorite films growing up, because that film alongside Guitar Hero are what got me into rock music to begin with. So, the career that Joan Cusack has had, TV show. But yes. Well, that is interesting. That's very interesting. She's been between 1985 and 1986. This is her first television appearance, folks. She was playing various characters in Saturday Night Live for our American viewers. She was Sheila Gallagher in the US version of Shameless. And you've got, she even voiced Glenda Wilkins in the episode Last Train to Bustville of Phineas and Ferb. She was in the series finale of The Office back in 2013. She would reprise her role of Jessie throughout the Toy Story franchise. In the two Toy Story shorts, especially Toy Story of Terror and Toy Story The Time Forgot. You'll say she reprised her role of Jessie in Halloween Vacation, Small Fry, Partysaurus Rex, and and Toy Story 3 and 4. Other notable film roles she has had She was Debbie Jelinski in Adam's Family Values in 1993. She was in Runaway Bride as Peggy Fleming the same year Toy Story 2 came out. High Fidelity as Liz back in 2000. School of Rock, I've mentioned. Principal Roselle Muff, Principal Mullins. She was the mother in Looney Tunes Back in Action the same year. Joan Carlyle in Ice Princess. She was Abby Mallard. She was Abby Mallard in Chicken Little. The day I cover Chicken Little is getting ever closer. Oh boy. Anyway, let's move swiftly on. She was in a. Yeah, this one was a little problematic, mainly because of how hideous the film was. Well, how hideous the film looked, anyway. The motion capture for Mars Needs Mums. That film looks hideous. Her last film role so far is Let It Snow as the tinfoil woman. Her latest television role is Francine Bunder for 3 episodes of Homecoming just last year. she also reprised Abby Mallard in 2 Chicken Little games, one in 2005 and one called Ace in Action in 2006. And she would be Jessie in the Toy Story 2 PS1 game, Buzz Lightyear to the Rescue, where you play as Buzz Lightyear. That was one of my favorite games growing up. The Toy Story 3 video game, a couple of Kinect games, Kinect Disneyland Adventures and Kinect Rush, a Disney Pixar adventure. And in 2016, Disney Magic Kingdoms. And she's got a few accolades to her name as well. She was nominated for 2 Oscars, both for Best Supporting Actress in In and Out in 1997 and Working Girl in 1988. Nominated for 5 Primetime Emmys and managed to win one. She was also nominated for a Golden Globe for Best Supporting Actress for In and Out. She was nominated for Outstanding Guest Actress in a Comedy Series for Shameless. And then she won. She had two nominations for Outstanding Guest Actress in a Comedy Series and then 2 more nominations for Outstanding Guest Actress in a Drama Series. And she actually won in that category back in 2015. 2005, Best Outstanding Performer in an Animated Program. She was nominated for a Daytime Emmy for that, for Peep and the Big Wide World. So she's got a lot of... She's got some big awards to her name. Anyway, the fact that Bullseye and Jessie are elated, especially Jessie, just constantly repeating, it's you, it's you, it's you, it's you, it's you! Just elated over the fact that Woody's back with them. But of course, first-time viewers will be thinking, how do they know Woody? On first time viewing, by the way, folks. Mm-hmm. But then we get introduced to the last of this gang, Stinky Pete, voiced by one Kelsey Grammer.
Sideshow Bob!
Right, okay, Bart. Okay, Bart, Lisa, calm down. Jeez, calm down. I said Kelsey Grammer, not Sideshow Bob. Yes, he voiced Sideshow Bob in The Simpsons. One of the greatest villains in Simpsons history. And he's... Where do we even begin with his resume. He has been a very, very busy bee. First television role called Ryan's Hope in 1979. He was a waiter on that episode, albeit uncredited. Dr. Fraser Crane in Cheers for over 200 episodes. He was in the Tracy Ullman show. Sideshow Bob. Still voices Sideshow Bob to this day. Made an appearance as Captain Morgan Bateson in the episode Cause and Effect for Star Trek The Next Generation. Fraser Crane has actually been in other TV shows. Cheers, I've mentioned. Mickey's 60th birthday, which was a special broadcast on the Magical World of Disney. Not sure how Fraser and Disney connect, but hey-ho. Fraser, which is actually getting rebooted next year, 2022. He was the voice of Snowball in the television film of Animal Farm. There was a musical television film where he played Ebenezer Scrooge in 2004 for A Christmas Carol. He made an appearance on Sesame Street. He was in The Troop, 30 Rock, Modern Family. He even made an appearance as the narrator in the episode Emerald Archer for Arrow. So he's been part of the Arrowverse as well. He's even been busy in the theatre as well. A few Shakespeare roles under his belt. Othello. The two main Shakespeare plays that he's got, Sweeney Todd under his belt as well. The two Shakespeare plays that he was involved with were Othello and the Scottish play. I can't say the actual name because we actually live in Scotland and it's just all the whole superstition behind saying the actual name of the play. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, for those that are clued in, they'll know exactly what I'm on about in regards to the Scottish play. Sweetie Todd, The Color Purple, Big Fish. He even made a couple of video game appearances. The Quest for the Code in 2003, and he even reprised his role as Sideshow Bob in the Simpsons game, which was a tie-in to the Simpsons movie released back in 2007.
An amazing game.
Yeah.
An amazing game.
Yeah. The Prodigal Son has returned. But the amazing thing that Jesse brings up is that up to this point, Stinky Pete, his box has never been opened. Still in effectively mint condition. Which reminds me, I've actually got a Finn Balor statue that's still sealed inside its box. So that's still in mint condition as well. I mean, I got that like 4 or 5 years ago. That's probably worth a fair bit now. But anyway, that's all those characters taken care of. That's one thing. We then see Woody's reaction to finding out that he's been part of something that was from yesteryear. He's part of something called Woody's Roundup, and he's part of the Roundup gang, which comprises of Woody, Jesse, Bullseye, and Pete. I'll just go with Pete, just make it easy for myself for the time being. But yeah, and then Bullseye gets the idea of switching on the TV, and Woody just gets so invested in these episodes of Woody's Roundup, which was an old kids show back in the Toy Story universe, of course.
I think it's a really smart scene as well, because when in the first film, obviously Buzz had that with like his kind of show, and he thought he was kind of
split,
almost like he believed he was real, and then you get this where obviously Woody knows he's a toy, but he kind of likes to believe that this is who he is, and he's done all these things and he just can't remember them.
Yeah. This I found very interesting. For the scene where Woody looks at the merchandise from Woody's Roundup, mock-ups of the toys were shown to Tom Hanks in the recording booth, and Hanks's spontaneous reactions to the toys were recorded, and those recordings were used for Woody's dialogue in that point in the film. I mean, that is very well played from Pixar to do that. I mean, because, look, let's face it, we'd be in awe. We'd be in awe as well if we were in Woody's position. Yeah. Rather than showing the clip from the film, I'm actually going to show you guys the TikTok that I made for this next bit. Because Rex is trying to find... Rex is trying to find the TV station that had the Alf Toy Barn commercial on it. And, yeah. And Ham's just like, look, step aside, I'll take care of this. we somewhat recreated that scene a couple of times on TikTok, and I'm actually gonna use the TikToks that I made rather than the footage, because I mean, look, when it comes to recreating movie scenes on social media platforms, I always have a blast with that. And they managed to find the TV station that's showing the commercial, etched just like, zoom. I still cannot fathom how quickly etch can. Anybody still want to teach us how to actually work the thing? But we'll say Buzz, Slinky, Rex, Ham. I think that's it. We'll say Buzz, Rex, Mr. Potato Head as well. They all go on this mission to get Woody back. They end up heading to Al's Toy Barn, which for some convenient reason is like literally across the road from where Al lives. And Al drives. You do know you can do something called walking to work? which yes, is a line that would be used in Monsters, Inc. So Woody still like really heavily invested in Woody's Roundup. As with a lot of us, getting invested into a TV show that we're watching for the very first time. I mean, that was me when I first started watching Cobra Kai. And it's hard to believe we've got 2 months to go until the new season drops, season 4, New Year's Eve. And we're gonna get the next All Valley tournament as well. And don't worry, folks, I will do a video talking about my favorite moments from every episode of Cobra Kai so far. 30 episodes to get through. So, no pressure then. Oh man, oh man, I love Cobra Kai. But yeah, it's a big love letter to longtime fans of the Karate Kid franchise. The exciting conclusion, Woody's finest hour. And Woody's like, okay, let's see that next episode. But unfortunately, yeah, doesn't happen. Well, to our knowledge, the episode would have already been recorded, but it never got shown. Because with what Pete says, once the astronauts went up, children only wanted to play with space toys, tying back to the first film. Because in this timeline, Woody's Roundup was cancelled in 1957, which is also the same year that director John Lasseter was born. So there you go. There's actually a couple of Life magazine. There's a couple of Life magazines. Yeah, here we are. The copy of Life magazine dated January 12th, 1957, sets the date for the height of Woody's popularity on TV. Woody's Roundup is clearly based on Howdy Doody, which ran from 1947 through 1960, seeing its peak at about 1955, a year or so before Woody's Roundup peaked in its own universe. The magazine cover also refers to the photos of the first satellite, Sputnik. This is apparently from an alternate universe because the Russians kept Sputnik a secret and did not announce it until it had a successful launch on October 4th, 1957. In the Toy Story universe, the satellite was launched a year earlier than in the real universe. The actual Life magazine story about Sputnik was published on October 21st, 1957. Wow, that's every day's a school day in the Kingdom of Isolation. What can I say?
Well, everything, I learn new things every single episode, if I'm honest. That's what I love about it.
Yeah. As I say, Woody's still in awe of all the merchandise from the show. A yo-yo, he's got like a face where face with a ball, you knock the teeth out. Yep, still a good looking guy. A bubble blower where you use the hat as the pump, and a little tie into one of his lines on his drawstring. What's the word I'm looking for here? The thing you press and the snake comes out.
Oh. Oh, no. Didn't tell you last week.
Yeah. But yeah, there's a snake in his boots. And then Bullseye ends up activating the record player. And then Woody and Bullseye decide to have a little bit of fun on the record player instead, speeding up and then starting to walk very slowly. And Jesse's having a laugh as well. And Woody's like, right, okay, let's get you on board, have a little bit of fun.
Okay,
and
now,
then
slow.
They decide to like speed up. They activate the controls on the record player that allows the record to like just like rotate faster, and it's as if they're running on a treadmill. And Jesse says, "Now we're a complete set." And Pete says, "Off to the museum." And Moody's just like, "Wait, museum? What?" And everyone falls off. Because turns out now the collection's complete, they can head to a museum in Japan. And this is where you've got the dilemma coming into play. Woody says he needs to get back to his owner, explains the story, and then we actually find out in Toy Story of Terror that Jesse is actually claustrophobic. And you can actually see some of that coming into play. And I did actually put in my notes here. Boom. Yep, there it is. Yeah. Okay, there it is. And PTSD triggered. Or something along those lines. Because Jessie's starting to hyperventilate. Because, like I say, it's implied that she's claustrophobic. Because of how long the three of them have been in storage. Whereabouts are we? While all that's kicking off, they're in the process. Al's about to get some group photos with everybody back together, and then the rest of the stitching on Woody's arm just comes off. And he's now a one-armed cowboy, and he ends up calling the repairman to get the job done, to get the arm sewn back on, and Pete, trying to be calm, he's trying to reassure Woody, it's just a popped seam, he'll be able to sew it back into place, and it's at this point that you've got Jessie coming across as really antagonistic towards Woody after he brought up the fact that he needs to get back to Andy. And while all that's going on, we've still got Buzz and the rest of his crew trying to get to Al's toy barn. They get there the following morning, and Ham, being as comedic as ever, he's like, "Why do the toys cross the road to get to the chicken? Oh, I'm the other side." And that's where we see Al, and that's where they see Al's toy bar. And it's just an absolute blur. I mean, Rex is just elated at the fact that he has managed to find what we can only assume to be a game guide that allows him to beat the game that we saw at the beginning of the film. And then they all split up, what ends up happening next? We see Buzz in an aisle of Buzz Lightyears, and he actually crosses paths with a newer version of Buzz with the shield belt that we saw again in the, which we again we saw in the opening scene of the film. So we got that, Shield Buzz. I'll go with Shield Buzz just to differentiate the two. Shield Buzz is acting like the original Buzz was in the first film, and he's just like, "Tell me, I wasn't this deluded."
It's one of the funniest scenes in the film, I think, just because of how self-aware it actually is.
Yeah, but that being said, you've got Rex, Slinky, Ham, and Mr. Potato Head. They're now in a pink aisle, And they end up coming across all these Barbies, which are very, this ends up leading to a fantastic in-joke between, in Pixar, because you've got a tour guide Barbie, but before that, the reaction from all four of them, Rex, Potato Head, Ham, and Slinky, just the reaction from them, I'm just sitting here like, oh boy. But anyway, Tour Guide Barbie. Now, the voice of Tour Guide Barbie, I have brought this name up previously. The voice of Ariel, Jodie Benson. Yeah, Jodie Benson, Disney, and Pixar. Jodie also did the voice of Lady in Lady and the Tramp 2, which is up there as one of my favorite Disney sequels. But again, just personal preference. But anyway, goes into full tour guide mode. Mr. Potato Head's like, I'm a married spider. And Ham's just like, well, move over, brother, single fellas. Really, Ham? but then Rex is just like, ah, it says how you defeat Zurg! And then they end up knocking themselves into this machine. They end up driving into this machine that has all these overly bouncy balls. You guys know the ones I'm on about. Yeah. And that somehow causes the car to spin. And then Rex ends up losing the game, guys. My soul of power! Come back! Who did anyone? Not that difficult. And then they managed to make a Jurassic Park reference. I mean, it's been parodied countless times. The whole objects in the mirror are closer than they appear. That's been parodied countless times since the first Jurassic Park film. But the fact that they managed to pay homage to that with Rex is just absolutely brilliant. But the in-joke here, it's just... here we go. While driving around Al's toy barn, the gang drives down the Buzz Lightyear aisle. Tour guide Barbie tells them back in 1995, short-sighted retailers did not order enough dolls to meet demand. This is an in-joke and a fact. When the original Toy Story was released in 1995, toy sellers did not think the movie would be a hit, and they indeed did not order enough dolls to keep up with demand. The joke is also a self-deprecating dig at Mattel Toys, which denied use of the Barbie character in the first film, thinking it would be a flop. That is possibly one of the best in-jokes I have ever come across. I mean, the thing is, unless you actually research this stuff for something like this, you wouldn't get these jokes. I mean, the kids wouldn't get these jokes anyway, but I mean, the parents and people like us that do these sort of shows, when you do your research with these sort of things, it's just absolutely brilliant. And imagine
that's the best comeback ever for being denied the use of a character, and then the next time you go to ask to use it, like, oh yeah, it did well the first time.
Yeah, but and then they end up coming across Shield Buzz, who ends up joining them after Rex says, "I know how to defeat Zurg." Now, of course, this is Shield Buzz, not real Buzz. Shield Buzz is thinking, "Yeah, I can actually beat the actual Emperor Zurg here." But all that carnage. But then we also... This next part is an absolute gut punch. A complete 180 from what we've seen earlier. You've got Jesse on the windowsill. Andy trying to like make amends with Jesse before he has to go. I'll say this is one of the saddest scenes in all of Pixar. Jesse going through her story about Emily, who was her owner. And then we get, having this particular song in the background doesn't make the scene any easier to watch, but it's still a beautiful song regardless. It's When She Loved Me by Sarah McLachlan. But still, this scene is an absolute gut punch. It effectively plays out the same way the beginning of the first film did, where you've got Andy happily playing with Woody, you've got Emily happily playing with Jesse, and then years are going by, and Emily's sort of like grown out of playing with Jesse and more into fashion at that point. And then she ends up finding Jesse under her bed. And then turns out she ends up in this box for like donations or something along those lines. And Jesse's just like, look, you just please just go. And I'm sitting here just, ouch.
It doesn't get any easier to watch that scene.
Nope.
The thing we watched, it hit harder because I knew the context behind it.
Yeah.
I actually felt like, oh no.
Yeah. But the thing with that particular song is that there was some discussion with regards to the song and its place in the film. Randy Newman expressed concern over whether or not young children would be able to sit through the entire song, because the song's about 3 minutes long and it's a slow song as well. So more likely than not, you're going to have kids that are going to be unlikely to be able to sit throughout that entire song. But and that's despite the fact that the song did move Tim Allen and Tom Hanks to tears. It's just, but yeah. But like I said, but the thing with this, it's like enjoying the song for like two completely different reasons now. I mean, first watching the film at like 6-7 years old when the film came out on VHS. Well, it was a VHS movie because we didn't have a DVD player at the time. That being said, I liked the song when the film came out, but now hearing it now, it's a lot deeper.
It hits a lot differently now.
Yeah.
Than it did before.
Yeah, and that's the thing with like all forms of entertainment, be it films, games, TV shows. Those things you enjoyed when you were younger, but as you grow older and you actually go back to revisit those things you enjoyed when you were younger, you actually find these sort of things out that you weren't as clued in on when you were younger. And then on top of that, with scenes like this, They hit a lot harder. They hit you in a completely different way compared to when you first saw them when you were younger. But yeah. Anyway. Woody's now actually contemplating whether he should go back to Andy or if he's actually going to stay. But that being said, he decides to stay, and that actually gives Jesse a bit of reassurance that he stay. Shield Buzz and the crew, they get to where Al's living. And this is what I was about to bring up earlier. When the toys arrive at the building where Al lives, across from Al's toy barn, it shows the elevator's highest point is the 23rd floor. If you look closely, you'll notice there's no 13th floor. Many hotels, apartment high-rises, and skyscrapers do not have a 13th floor due to superstition. Why am I not surprised? The elevator goes from the 12th floor to the 14th floor. Therefore, Al's apartment being on the 23rd floor is actually only 22 floors up. Interesting. Very interesting. I never even picked up on that. Something else regarding Al's car. It actually took them over a month to digitally paint Al's car. But
it kind of shows you the commitment they put into making the films, though, with the amount of time they've able to make certain aspects.
Regarding that, now you've mentioned it, there's a very well-known story regarding the production of Toy Story 2. There's actually a couple of parts to this story. The first part is the fact that this film almost never happened. Why? Because there was one particular point. Here we go. This is what we're after. The work done on the film was nearly lost in 1998 when one of the animators, while routinely clearing some files, accidentally entered the deletion code /bin/rm-r --f** on the root folder of the Toy Story 2 assets on Pixar's Eternal Service. Associate Technical Director Oren Jacob was one of the first to notice as character models disappeared from their works in progress. They shut down the file servers, but had already lost 90% of the last 2 years' work. And it was also found that the backups had not been working for about a month.
Yep.
That is very concerning. Thankfully, the film was saved when technical director Galen Sussman, who had been working from home to take care of her newborn child, revealed she had backups of the assets on her home computer. The Pixar team was able to recover nearly all of the lost assets, save for a few recent days of work, allowing the film to proceed. But, that's not the end of the issues. Because it turns out, it turns out, at one point, they ended up having to rewrite the entire story over an entire weekend, which they managed to do because the initial story they had, it did not go down well. So they might, But like I say, they managed to rewrite the story. But, and it's a big but here, folks. Bearing in mind, they still have to stick to the deadline. How long do you reckon they had to effectively make the film from scratch again? How long do you reckon they had before the deadline?
I don't know. That's a good question.
Only 9 months.
What did he say?
9 months to make an entire film from scratch.
Yeah, that's not... Especially how long they put... And like I said before, they put so much time and effort into these films. That's a crazy... Crazy amount of time to ask.
Yeah. But somehow they managed to pull it off. With even with some of the crew working 24 to 36 hour shifts just to try and get the work done. And some of them did end up with repetitive strain injury among many other issues from just how much time they were spending in front of the computer screens every day.
That's crazy.
Yeah, but like I say, but as we'll see in the legacy portion of the scores, it all paid off in the end. And yes, they did manage to meet the deadline. I'll get into more of that in the legacy portion of the scores. So the crew are wondering how on earth they're going to get to the 23rd floor. And then Rex is thinking to himself, right, let's see if we have some balloons we can float to the top. But Mr. Potato Head has another idea. We stack ourselves up, push the button, and pretend we're delivering a pizza. And...
it's a master plan right there.
Yeah. I need to find the script for this bit. That's the one we need. There we go. That's the quote I need. This bit's brilliant. This next bit's brilliant. From ham, no less. How about a ham sandwich with fries, pointing to Mr. Potato Head, and a hot dog, pointing to Slinky. And then Rex chimes in, what about me? You can be the toy that comes with a meal. Anybody want a McDonald's now? And yes, that joke's a bit on the nose, but still, well played. Because I can only imagine at the time they would have had Toy Story 2 toys in the Happy Meals at McDonald's.
In fact, they did, because I remember we ended up getting the full set. Yeah, we did.
We got the full set toys.
Yeah.
Nice.
Don't even know what happened to them. Oh no. Don't tell me they've been donated. Oh no.
We need to wait till Toy Story 3 before we go into donation territory.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
But yeah. So let's see, whereabouts are we? Yes. And while all that's happening, the real Buzz ends up by accident freeing Emperor Zurg from his box. And he's just simply destroy Buzz Lightyear, destroy Buzz Lightyear. I mean the music for Zurg at that point. Yeah, villain music 101, ladies and gentlemen. But anyway. But right, whereabouts are we? Whereabouts are we? So Zogan's up catching up with the everybody else. I've skipped over an entire part here. I'm at the right part here. Yeah. So I hadn't skipped over. I'll get there, folks. Bear with me. I'll get there eventually. The real boss manages to catch up, and that's after everything kicks off, where you've got where you've got the crew there. Buzz thinks that Woody's being tortured. And Rex is like, wait, what do we do? And then Shield Buzz goes, use your head. The thing is, Rex didn't mean literally lose your head.
But
your
I don't want to use my head! So the
grate opens, and then, oh boy, all hell breaks loose. Mr. Potato Head is trying to go in for his angry eyes, and he ends up bringing the shoes out. but then the real Buzz comes in. The real Buzz comes in, and actually convinces it. He manages to get everybody back on his side to explain what's going on. We get a couple of callbacks to the argument that Buzz and Woody had at the Dinoco garage in the first film. Where Buzz explains to Woody that he's not a collector's item, that he's a toy. And then one more rip and then he's done with me. What do I do then, Buzz? Huh? You tell me. Like I said in the first Toy Story film, this is only their third film, and they are somehow able to nail these mature concepts and still make them understandable for kids. Beggars believe how they manage that. So
everybody, I think that's also why they still have so much power nowadays, is they're so masterfully crafted to have so much meaning behind every scene.
Exactly. Be it callbacks or deeper meanings that you'll be able to understand when you're a bit older. Mm-hmm. Talking of which, once everyone decides to leave. We end up getting our heartstrings pulled here, where you've got the puppet Woody from Woody's Roundup, singing the theme of, let's just say, the theme of the franchise, You've Got a Friend in Me. Regarding the first film, that song is just so iconic.
Mm-hmm.
Something I just realized I forgot to bring up regarding the guy that managed to repair Woody's arm. The Pixar short that came out with A Bug's Life, Jerry's Game, That's actually Jerry from that short that repairs Woody's arm.
Oh, I've never seen that short. Only time we watch it, though.
Yeah. I'm certain all the Pixar shorts that have been made are on Disney Plus right now. I'm certain they are. But anyway, Woody ends up having the realization after he wipes off the varnish, because under the varnish is of course Andy's name. He says to everybody, like, look, you're right. I can't stop Andy from growing up, but I wouldn't miss it for the world. And Pete's just like, wait, what? No, why? And then Woody manages to coax Jesse and Bullseye into coming along with him. And then, yeah, this part, a lot of people would have just been legitimately like, wait, what? Turns out Stinky Pete's the villain.
See, I think they did this really smart thing where they have two, like, I would still say that Al is a villain, but if it, obviously as the movie becomes less involved and it moves on to Stinky Pete, I really like that, and I think that's quite smart. Technically three villains, if we're going to count Zug.
That's a valid point. Wait, don't get too ahead of yourself. The Roundup Gang are in these foam collector, whatchamacallit, in the suitcases they go. This is now the problem when you've got both buzzers in the same scene. I don't know which one is which one's which. Yeah. One buzz goes quick to the elevator and then.
So we meet again, Buzz Lightyear, for the last time.
And Rex is like, oh, watch out, he's got an ion blaster that pops out rubber balls. Just like, pew, 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 pew. But you actually see at one point, it may be a reference, it might not be a reference, I don't know. It might be a reference to Spinal Tap where the destruction level turns up to 11. Like I said, it might be a reference to Spinal Tap, it might not. That remains to be seen.
I've been to the past. This film is full, and I mean chock-a-full of references.
Yeah, references, Easter eggs, and not just to Pixar films, folks.
Yep.
But of course, as I've mentioned Star Wars, you can't go through a scene with somebody saying you killed my father without the villain going, I am your father.
No!
You cannot get through any movie scene with a supposed father-son confrontation without them referencing that moment from Empire.
It's such a silly moment in the film, but it is amazing. So funny.
Yeah, but of course, like I say, destruction turned up to 11. Prepare to die. Rex is like, can't look, and somehow his tail whacks Zug off the elevator. And Rex is he's like in disbelief. I actually beat Zug.
It's a proud moment for him because he'd obviously been said at the start how he really wanted to beat Zug, and then he does, and it's just such a heartwarming moment.
Yeah. But Al's now driving to the airport, And everybody's just missed them. How are we going to get them now? Pizza, anyone? Oh, yeah, the Pizza Planet truck. gotta love the Pizza Planet truck. And of course, just like in the first film, you've got like a departure from the traditional Randy Newman, not Elfman. He's not related to Danny. We get a slight departure from the traditional Randy Newman music. Yes, Randy Newman's back to do the music for the film. So we've got that. Shield Buzz decides to do a bit of catching up with his dad.
It's a heartwarming moment.
Yeah.
It's a beautiful moment.
Beautiful, but silly in some aspects at the same time.
Oh yeah, for sure.
But still great regardless. they definitely met. I could have sworn they referenced Star Trek here as well. Bear with me. Right, that should be it. Right, there we go. I've just realized that's what the Star Trek reference was. When Buzz does that, Vulcan.
Why?
That was the Star Trek reference I was trying to. That was the Star Trek reference I was trying to find. Okay, now we've got that out of the way. Okay, back to business. He's at a red light. Al's at the red light. Maximum power slink. But, oh, goody, we've got the aliens back. And you've got, and you've got Jeff Pigeon doing doing the voice of the aliens here. Use the wand of power. That would be the gear shift. and they're driving like your traditional Pizza Planet driver. Which actually got me thinking, someone needs to hire Buzz and his team. But then sharp left turn and the aliens almost go out the window. And Mr. Potato Head is holding them on. I seriously doubt he's getting that kind of mileage. there we go, that's what we're after. So they get to the airport after a sharp right turn. Aliens get back into the car. You have saved our lives. We are eternally grateful. they get to the airport and they're actually using one of these pet carriers. But the thing with that is there's a gag where Buzz walks inside a pet carrier, which should be impossible, but the short angle masks the physics of it. However, later, the carrier tumbles over, revealing t- tumbles over, revealing leg holes. So the filmmakers clearly thought it through. Yeah. And now I know a lot of you are thinking to yourselves, where's A113? Where's the A113? We've got the Pizza Planet truck. Where's A113? Well, regarding that, we do have an A113 over the PA system. Lasset Air Flight A113. Lasset Air, Lasseter. Anyway, they end up in the airport baggage area, where you've got all these cases, and of course, you couldn't leave well enough alone, Pixar. You couldn't leave well enough alone. You've got one green case going one way, and you've got another green case going in the other direction. The crew split. They chase both green cases. Ugh. I've lost count of how many times that gag's been used. And it turns out... But turns out the first green case that gets opened is flash photography stuff, which actually comes in quite handy very shortly, because Buzz manages to get to the actual green case that's got the Roundup gang in it. Pete punches Buzz over the railing, and then with his pickaxe, just ching on Woody's arm again. Your choice, Woody. You can go to Japan together or in pieces. If he fixed you once, he can fix you again. Now get in the box! And Woody's just like, no, I ain't going in there. And he's almost accepting his fate. And then, boom, flash photography. Just for the benefit and safety of those with photosensitive epilepsy, I'm not going to show that flash photography clip, because who knows? But if you've seen the film, you'll know which bit we're at. Woody says Pete's about to find out the true definition of playtime. And you've got this kid that ends up with Pete in their back, in their rucksack. Big ugly man doll could use a makeover. And then you've got this Barbie doll next to him. You'll like Amy. She's an artist, and just and Pete's just like, oh no, I am done. And then we get to the real climax of the film, because you've got Jesse still in that case. Bullseye's managed to get out, no problem, but Jesse stuck in there for the time being. So Buzz and Woody are on Bullseye, and Woody goes onto the baggage transporter onto the plane, which is Far East Airways. I think it's Far East Airways or Far East Airlines. It's one of the two. But the plane just says Far East. I don't know whether it's airlines or airways or whatever. But anyway, that being said, Woody gets onto the plane, manages to get to the case Jesse's in, and they're just about to get off, and then door shut, too late, put them on the next flight! And this bit's intense. Mm-hmm. In a very exciting way, because they're trying to work their way through the down the wheels of the plane, and then Woody slips, and Jesse manages to grab onto Woody, albeit on his albeit on the arm that's been chipped. And you actually see it starting to rip a little bit more. About to lose his hat. Buzz manages to catch it. Woody uses his drawstring, manages to get it onto one of the nuts, and says to Jesse, let go of the plane, pretend it's the final episode of Woody's Roundup. And Jesse just like effectively amplifying the points that it got cancelled. We never found out if you made it. And then Woody, without directly seeing it, says, trust me, let's find out together. Jesse lets go. They get onto Buzz and they made it. They made it. So, which then leads us to assume, yeah, that would have been how the final episode ended.
Which I think is quite a nice way, because throughout the film, you're kind of wondering what did happen. Like, did he make it?
Yeah, exactly. That being said, Andy gets back home. I've just realized I've been calling it summer camp this whole episode. It's cowboy camp. Cowboy camp for the weekend.
That was a camp.
Yeah. Yeah. I was like, Andy's back from camp. He gets back into his room. He goes to get Woody from his shelf. Woody's not there, but turns out all the toys are there. Etch-a-Sketch, welcome back. New toys there. Jesse and Bullseye. Jesse, interestingly, is the only female toy that Andy has in his possession. All the other female toys belong to Molly. So Andy manages to fix Woody's arm, and this is just we end up with an innuendo here, where Buzz is trying to get out but is unable to, but Jesse. Onto the loop-de-loop that we saw from the first film. Loop-de-loop. Gets onto the door handle. Opens it. And then buzzes wings. Shing! I will say, it's one of the more creative innuendos.
Yeah.
And then you've got Ham trying to beat the Zerg game that we saw at the start of the film. Try to get Rex to help him, saying, I don't need to play it, I lived it. And then Ham ends up getting a game over. And then you see Al, what goes around comes around. He looks a little bit distraught after what happened with the whole fiasco regarding the Roundup gang. So he's now stuck working at Al's toy barn effectively for the rest of his days.
Good. That's what he gets for stealing.
Yep. And then Ham goes, well, I guess crime doesn't pay. Which is, I mean, that's brilliant. That is brilliant. Mrs. Potato Head decides, let's adopt the aliens after they say, because they kept saying, you have saved our lives, we are eternally grateful. And then they call Mr. Potato Head Daddy, and Wheezy's got himself a new squeaker. And then he ends up saying, in fact, I think I feel a song coming on. And then we get a big band version of You've Got a Friend in Me, performed by Robert Goulet. But like I say, it's a big band version of the song, but still an iconic song. And I say, if anything, part of me actually prefers this big band version over the original. Nothing against the original, but it's just there's just something about the big band version that actually hits a little harder, that it's in a good way. But yeah, and then we get to probably of all the outtakes that were released, be it Monsters, Inc., Bugs Life, Toy Story 2, I think those are like the only three that were on VHS. Of those three, Toy Story 2 is easily my favorite. Monsters, Inc., a very, very close second. The outtakes are great. And then you've got the tour guide Barbie from earlier, effectively breaking the fourth wall, saying like, remember to get all your rubbish into the nearest rubbish bin. And actually throughout these end credits, you've actually got the theme song to Woody's Roundup, which is performed by Riders in the Sky, playing over the end credits as well. And that is that. That is Toy Story 2. What an amazing follow-up to the first song. I mean, this is one of those cases of what can be said that hasn't already been said. But nevertheless, time to get into the scores. The story I gave a 9 because I think part of it's down to the fact that you got a couple of, the story is fantastic, don't get me wrong, but I just feel there were like a couple of beats that felt too similar to some of the beats from the first film. But like I say, not taking anything away from the story at all, but it's just a minor criticism. What would you give the story, Jack?
I would give it an 8, and one of those reasons as well is I think there's a lot of villains were added into the story, and I think see if they'd focused on Stinky Pete. I know the Zerg was more of a gag, but even if they'd focused more on Al, I think it would have been cooler, because Al, I would argue, was more evil than Stinky Pete in the end, because Al essentially stole his toy from a child.
Yeah.
Whereas Stinky Pete just, I wouldn't say he was as much a villain, he was just desperate.
Yeah. So that gives us a score of 8.5 for the story between us. So, actually taking that into account now, with what you've just said, I did have the characters at a 10, but I've just bumped it down to a 9, taking what Jack said into account.
I would give it a 9 as well, in fairness. I think the characters are really strong. I just feel if they focused on some of them more than they did, they would have been even better. But all the characters are solid. There's not one bad character.
Yeah, absolutely. I say, again, it's another case that they're very well written. And the returning characters, especially Woody, who's like the primary focus of this film, compared to, I would say, Buzz in the I would say in a way, Buzz was like the primary focus of the first film, because he had to accept that he was a toy, not an actual Space Ranger. But Woody, learning he's a collector's item, and he had to choose whether to be the collector's item for the rest of his life or going back to Andy's. So, like I say, the returning characters, they're more fleshed out now. And the new characters that have now been established, like Jesse and Bullseye, have now become firm fan favorites in the franchise, like I mentioned earlier. I'm sticking with a 10 for that one. You can definitely see that there is even more polish compared to the first film. The first film was just like sort of like a starter point. It was like the first proper computer animated film. Here, now they've got more experience under their belt. The film is a lot, I think, you can see the quality of the animation. It is a lot more polished.
Mm-hmm. I would have to agree with you there. The visuals, even, I think last time I said that the visuals were stunning and obviously all the craftsmanship behind them, I would argue they're just polished perfection. So it has to be a 10 from me.
There we go. Soundtrack. Soundtrack, that one I gave a 10 as well. Woody's Roundup, it definitely gives you that vibe of that old school 1950s like kids show and then of course the instruments used for the composition of the theme song for Woody's Roundup, definitely getting that old school Western feel for it. The score, again, fantastic job from Randy Newman for the score for this film. And then When She Loved Me, Sarah McLachlan, easily one of the most beautiful songs that has been used for an animated film. And that's saying a lot, because you don't often get a song like that in this sort of film.
I completely agree with you. And I think from the first film, there was a lot of iconic kind of songs, but I would say even the big band version of You've Got a Friend in Me and obviously When She Loved Me and stuff, I just think the soundtrack is phenomenal in Toy Story 2.
Yeah. So the last thing to get onto now is, of course, the legacy. Now, as I often do now, I actually go through everything the film has achieved, like what's been done afterwards. But a little change-up this time around. Because this is a sequel, what we're going to be taking into account now is how it compares to its predecessor. The only time we've done that previously was with The Rescuers Down Under. Mm-hmm. And we're gonna be doing this a lot more often with the Pixar sequels, because there are a few Pixar sequels out there, mm-hmm. and in one or two cases prequels as well. But we'll get to that later down the road. So anyway, box office for Toy Story. It was released. It got its premiere at the El Capitan Theater on November 13th, 1999. And it got released November 24th, about 2 weeks later. Runtime of 92 minutes, budget of $90 million, and it got a worldwide box office total of $497 million at the box office. So successful. It was the highest grossing animated film of 1999. And at the time, it became the highest grossing animated film of all time, behind The Lion King and Aladdin. Toy Story over the Thanksgiving Day weekend. A 3-day tally of $57.4 million over its opening weekend. That's not bad going for the opening weekend.
Not at all.
An average of $17,734 per theater over the 3-day period. And that was from over 3,000 theaters across the U.S. By New Year's Day, it had made more than $2 million in the U.S. alone. Box Office Mojo estimated that the film sold over 47.8 million tickets in the United States and Canada, and it set a 3-day opening record in the U.K., grossing £7.7 million, I don't know how much that would be back in 1999, but how much would that be worth today? It's to load. So while that's loading, critical reception. I mentioned previously that the first Toy Story film got a 100% rating on Rotten Tomatoes. Let's see if it still has it now. Pretty sure it still does. Because I mean, there's only like a handful of films throughout all of movie history that have a 100% rating on Rotten Tomatoes. Yep, the first Toy Story film still has 100%. And Toy Story 2. Right, come on. Is it my connection still on? There it is. Yep, Toy Story 2 also has a 100% rating on Rotten Tomatoes, which is, I mean, not bad going. Now let's. What is the score from the audience? 87% rating on Rotten Tomatoes from the audience. Slightly lower than Toy Story 1 with 92%, but still a very respectable score on Rotten Tomatoes. Right, 7700000. Right, so that should be the 7.7. Right, £7.7 million in 1999 equates to. We'll round that up to £11.7 million in today's money, adjusted for inflation. So. So what will that equate to in dollars? Again, I'll just round it up. So in the UK, over its three-day opening weekend, adjusted for inflation, it got the equivalent of $16 million in today's money. That's 16, not 60. Because UK, slightly smaller population than North America.
Just slightly.
But still, like I say, $16 million in today's money over a three-day weekend in the UK. So I'll say that's not bad going. And now, the accolades. Whew. Where do we begin with the accolades? Looney Tunes animator Chuck Jones wrote a letter to Lasseter after seeing the film, heavily praising the film. So you've got that. So you've got that in its favor. The American Society of Composers, Authors, and Publishers Film and Television Music Awards. Top box office films of 2000 award, a win for Randy Newman on that one. Nominated for 2 Saturn Awards, Best Fantasy Film and Best Music for Randy Newman. Nominated for an Oscar for Best Original Song for When She Loved Me, which ended up losing out to You'll Be In My Heart from Tarzan, another Disney offering. And believe it or not, folks, that was also the same year Blame Canada was nominated. Now, some of you are thinking to yourselves, Blame Canada, South Park Bigger, Longer, and Uncut. Disney and Pixar nominated in the same category as South Park.
That doesn't make sense.
I know, right? But that being said, that's still pretty good going. The Annie Awards is where it got the bulk of its wins. Managed to win for Best Animated Theatrical Feature. It got nominated for Outstanding Individual Achievement for Character Animation for Doug Sweetland. Outstanding. It managed to win for outstanding individual achievement for directing and for music. John Lasseter, Lee Unkrich, and Ash Brannan were the directors, and Randy Newman with the music. Nominated for outstanding individual achievement for production design, William Cohn and Jim Pearson were nominated for that. And then the rest of the awards it was nominated for, it won outstanding individual achievements for storyboarding for Dan Jupp and Joe Ranft, and two voice acting Annie Awards at this point as well. Outstanding individual achievement for voice acting by a female performer for Joan Cusack as Jessie. Hard to argue with that. And outstanding individual achievement for voice acting by a male performer for Tim Allen. And the last Annie it won, outstanding individual achievement for writing in an animated feature production. And that's John Lasseter, Pete Docter, Ash Brannan, Andrew Stanton, Rita Haseo, Doug Chamberlain, and Chris Webb. They all helped with the story and the screenplay. Blockbuster Entertainment Awards, Best Family Film. It won a Bogey Award. It won a Bogey Award, which is an award ceremony in Germany for some bizarre reason. Broadcast Film Critics Association Awards, Best Animated Film, it won for that. It was nominated for Best Casting for an Animated Voiceover in a Feature Film with Ruth Lambert in the Casting Society of America. It won a Golden Globe for Best Picture in the Musical or Comedy category. It was nominated for Best Original Song with When She Loved Me. It got three Kids' Choice Awards nominations for Nickelodeon. Favorite movie, favorite voice from an animated movie for Tim Allen and Tom Hanks. Nominated for an MTV Movie Award for Best On-Screen Duo for Tim Allen and Tom Hanks. Was nominated for Best Sound Editing at the Motion Picture Sound Editing Awards. Online Film Critics Society, Best Film, Best Original Screenplay. Nominated in the Satellite Awards for Best Motion Picture, Animated or Mixed Media, and Best Original Song for When She Loved Me. It won for the Young Artist Award for Best Family Feature Film, which was animated. In 2001, it won the Best Song Written for a Motion Picture, Television, or Other Visual Media at the Grammys. Pixar have a Grammy to their name now with When She Loved Me, and it was nominated for Best Score Soundtrack Album with Randy Newman. Best Country Performance by a Duo or Group with Vocals with Riders in the Sky for Woody's Roundup. So Woody's Roundup got nominated for a Grammy as well. How's about that?
That's unexpected.
Yeah. Woody's Roundup, I mean, yes, it's a short song, but it got nominated for a Grammy. That is incredible. And at the 2005 Satellite Awards, Outstanding Youth DVD for the two-disc special edition. One for that. American Film Institute nominated. Buzz Lightyear was nominated as the hero in the 100 Heroes and Villains list. 100 Songs nominated for When She Loved Me in 2004. And it was nominated in the top 10 animated films list. The video game I mentioned previously, Toy Story 2, Buzz Lightyear to the Rescue, PC, PlayStation, Nintendo 64, and the Dreamcast in November 1999. The game featured the original cast and clips from the film as introductions to the levels. Once earned, these clips can be viewed at the player's discretion. Another game was released for the Game Boy Color. And then we would get a sequel to the film in Toy Story 3 in 2010. And then 9 years later with Toy Story 4. So yeah, the 9 months that it took to effectively make the film from scratch was worth it. And some of the crew ended up taking as much as a year off just to recover from the strenuous work schedule that they had. So yeah, the legacy for me gets an 11.
Oh, I don't know. I somewhat agree with you. Do you know what? Yeah, I have to agree with you. There's just so much that the film did, and
yeah,
it did so well as a sequel, and it definitely deserves it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So, but like I said, this film does help flesh out the returning characters. They're more developed now, especially Woody and Buzz. The new characters that come into play, they are fantastic throughout. And compared to the original, look, both films are fantastic, but what could be said that hasn't already been said? So, taking everything into account, that's the scores in, and we get ourselves a 99%, which means Toy Story 2 is now top of the scoreboard ahead of the first Toy Story film by 1%. So the scoreboard as it stands, Toy Story 2 with 99%, Toy Story with 98%, and A Bug's Life with 90%. And there we go, we are done. So that's that out of the way. The next episode, we'll see what score we can get out of those screen canisters and see what we can get on those scoreboards. See if we can break that all-time scare record with Monsters, Inc. Jack, once again, thanks for joining me for this. Can't wait to cover Toy Story 3 with you later down the road.
No, I can't wait.
Yeah. And big thanks to you guys, as always, for continuing to support this series. I hope you've enjoyed this episode and learned a few things along the way as well. If you did enjoy this episode, hit the thumbs up. And if you want to be part of the Kingdom of Isolation yourself, you can hit the subscribe button down at the bottom and click the bell to join the Dream Chasers notification squad so you don't miss anything that we do on this channel. The next video I'm going to be doing on my channel is going to be going through the films that I went to see. Well, so like, I would say they're like bite-sized reviews, but I'm like, so like putting them into like one big video. The films that I went to see at the Odeon, at the cinema over the course of the last month. And I'll be doing rapid fire through them, what I liked about the films, what I didn't like about them. I've got a couple of classic films in that mix as well, because yes, the Odeon is showing classic films as well. I'll be going through the films that I saw at the Odeon throughout October, and the next episode of The Kingdom of Isolation is going to be covering Monsters, Inc. But until then, folks, we will see you guys next time in The Kingdom of Isolation.